You're listening to the audio production of Rembrandt Is in the Wind, Audio Study by Russ Ramsey, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
I want to help you learn to love art. Art, for whatever reason, can sometimes be an intimidating subject, but there's so much beauty and wonder, and it's a wonderful thing to develop a lifelong relationship with. And so what we're going to do is we're going to talk through some of the artists that perhaps you know, perhaps you'll become familiar with as we go through this series. We're going to talk about certain works of art and stories, and we're going to talk about the creative process, what it means to be creative people, and what it means to be people who pursue goodness, truth, and beauty, particularly beauty. So I can't wait to get into this. We're going to jump right in by talking about a self-portrait painted by Vincent van Gogh. In his book, The Return of the Prodigal Son, Henry Nouwen wrote this. He said, "Our brokenness has no other beauty but the beauty that comes from the compassion that surrounds it." In other words, our wounds are not beautiful in themselves, but the story behind their healing is. But how can we tell the story of our healing if we hide the wounds that need it? If you've ever tried to make a realistic self-portrait, here's what you find out. Only the truth will work. In my high school art class, I was given this assignment to draw a self-portrait. So I had my piece of paper and a mirror, and as I went back and forth from the mirror to the paper, I did try to draw what I saw, but I also wanted to improve upon what I saw. I wanted to give myself brighter eyes and maybe a more chiseled nose and greater definition in my cheekbones and maybe a little less of a baby face. Here's what my vanity got me. It got me a portrait of somebody who did not really look like me and a gracious B-. Vincent van Gogh, who lived from 1853 to 1890, painted over 40 self-portraits, but one of his self-portraits stands out to me as being brutally honest. It's self-portrait with bandaged ear. He painted it in January of 1889, the year that he also produced Starry Night, and the year before, he died from a gunshot wound to the abdomen. If you know anything about Vincent van Gogh outside of his art, perhaps what you know is that he was a tortured soul. Vincent suffered from depression and paranoia, public outbursts so disconcerting that in March of 1889, 2 months after he painted self-portrait with bandaged ear, 30 of his neighbors in his little village of Arles, France, petitioned the police to deal with this one they referred to as the red-headed madman, which the officers did by removing him from his rented flat, which was called the Yellow House, made famous in his painting, The Bedroom. Shortly after his eviction notice, Vincent admitted himself into an asylum for the mentally ill, the St. Paul Asylum in Saint-Remy-de-Provence. Back in those days, most psychological maladies were simply lumped together and called madness. If you had debilitating depression, that was madness. Bipolar disorder, madness. Paranoia, even acute epilepsy, they all fell under the umbrella of this diagnosis called madness. And the treatment for madness often involved stays in an asylum. And so, labeled as such by his own community, the red-headed madman checked himself in and remained in Saint-Remy for a year, from May of 1889 to May of 1890. What drove Vincent to check himself into the asylum? What made his neighbors think that he was mad and petition for his removal from their community? Though there were many contributing factors, the most ubiquitous episode came several weeks before his eviction from the Yellow House. He and his flatmate, the Impressionist painter Paul Gauguin, had a falling out, and Vincent took a blade to his ear and he cut off the lobe, and he wrapped it in paper and he took it to a local prostitute named Rachel, who seemed to have been his friend in his community of folks who lived on the fringes. And when he handed her that blood-soaked parcel, he said, "Take it, it will be useful." Well, word of this outburst spread quickly throughout the village, and then the next morning, the police found Vincent asleep in his bed covered in blood. And they took him to the hospital, and during his stay, Vincent began to count the cost of what he had lost. He'd lost his roommate, his friend, the fellow artist, Paul Gauguin. He felt responsible for this. His body was now permanently maimed. His neighbors all knew the story about his ear. And to add insult to injury, at the time Vincent cut off his ear, his star was just beginning to rise in the art world. After years of obscurity, he was on the verge of breaking through. And so his public spectacle with his bloody ear, which led to his eviction and detention in the asylum, brought with it a mountain of humiliating professional and public shame on top of everything else. So what did Vincent do while he was recovering in that hospital stay? Well, he painted. He painted close to 140 paintings that year, and at least two of those works were self-portraits with his bandaged ear showing. He captured the moment of his greatest shame. It's hard to render an honest self-portrait if we want to conceal what is unattractive and hide what is broken. We want to appear beautiful, but when we do this, we hide what needs redemption. And we hide what we trust Christ to redeem. And what's redeemed is beautiful. And beauty matters. Philosophers have long wrestled with the question, what makes humanity so distinct from all other forms of life? There are three properties of being, or what they call transcendentals, that have risen to the surface. They are the human desire for goodness, the human desire for truth, and the human desire for beauty. Christian theologians have regarded these three transcendentals as basic human desires that are essential for knowing God. Why? Because these are three properties that define God's nature. Honesty and falsehood point to the existence of absolute truth. Good and evil point to the reality of undefiled holiness. Beauty and the grotesque whisper to our souls that there is such a thing as glory. And so truth and goodness and beauty were established for us by the God who is defined by all three. The pursuit of goodness and the pursuit of truth and the pursuit of beauty are, in fact, foundational to the health of any community. And this isn't just a philosophical position, it's a biblical one. We see it in the opening chapters of the book of Genesis, in the very beginning of the Bible. What are the first things we learn about humanity from Scripture? Well, first, in Genesis 1, we learn about goodness. We learn that when God created us, He pronounced His creation very good. Goodness has been a foundational part of our intended design since the beginning. The second thing we see is that just as we were created with inherent goodness, and we're also called to functional goodness, we were made to live according to the truth. We were meant to obey God. In other words, we were created to live according to God's truth, which is absolute truth, with a clear divide between what is evil and what is good. Consider the importance of truth. What precipitated the fall of man? Deception. Scripture says the serpent deceived the woman and the man, and they in turn lied to God and to themselves. And that rejection of the truth has brought immeasurable sorrow upon our species, and we have been longing to reclaim some sense of what is true and good ever since. In the confines of our created world, this is a uniquely human phenomenon. We are the only creatures who are consciously concerned with goodness and truth. We're the only ones. The third thing that we see has to do with beauty. We participate in beauty. Genesis 1 and 2 tells us that we are made in God's image, meaning we're created to be creative. And we see this responsible to create in the act of naming the birds and the beast, this task that God assigned to Adam. Maria Popova wrote, "To name a thing is to acknowledge its existence as separate from everything else that has a name, to confer upon it the dignity of autonomy, while at the same time affirming its belonging with the rest of the nameable world, to transform its strangeness into familiarity, which is the root of empathy," end quote. Creativity is a path to beauty. The creative work of naming is the work of ascribing dignity and speaking truth. How do we pursue goodness and truth and beauty? Again, we look to Genesis 1 and 2 with two final observations here. The first has to do with work. We see that creativity is bound up in the act of work itself. Adam's creative work was a beautifying work. He was engaged in the true oldest profession, which is landscaping or gardening. Adam didn't just live in Eden, he worked on Eden. And the call to create stems from our first parents' call to care for and to beautify Eden. Every one of us has an ember of that fire still smoldering in our hearts. When we set out to make something beautiful, we're drawing in some way, however corrupted it may be from the fall, on that ancient instinct to care for and to beautify Eden. And the other thing that we see has to do with community. We learn that it is not good for people to be alone. When God gave Adam Eve, he didn't just give the man a wife. He gave him community. He gave him others. In fact, together, Adam and Eve created others in the sense that they were acting as what Tolkien described as sub-creators. We were created to create and to do that in the context of community and for the benefit of community. So we're called to engage in goodness and truth and beauty and to pursue them in the context of our work and our relationships. Vincent van Gogh's self-portrait with bandaged ear indicts us. How willing are we to lead with the fact that we've got a lot of things in us that aren't right? Self-portrait with bandaged ear hangs in my office to remind me, I'm a pastor, and it reminds me that I'm drawing the self-portrait. And if I'm drawing the self-portrait dishonestly, pretending that I'm okay and not in need of any help, then what I'm actually doing is I'm concealing from others the fact that I'm broken. The truth is, my wounds need binding. I need asylum. And if I can't show that honestly, how will anyone ever see Christ in me? Or worse, what sort of Christ will they see? In Vincent's case, there is a sweet bit of irony here. Self-portrait with bandaged ear, in which Van Gogh willingly captures the moment of his own spiritual and relational poverty, is now worth millions. That canvas faithfully captures a defining moment of shame and need for rescue by showing the bandaged side, and it's become this priceless treasure. It's filled with truth and goodness and beauty in his work and in his relationships, how he shows himself to us. This is how God sees his people. We are fully exposed in our shortcomings, and at the same time, we are of unimaginable value to him. And because this is so, this is how we should see others. And it's how we should be willing to be seen by others, broken and of incalculable worth. Why does beauty matter? Why is the pursuit of beauty essential for our spiritual well-being? Well, beauty is a power that is wielded by the hand of God. Consider Abraham, for example. When God promised Abraham that he would become the father of a great nation, a great community, what did the Lord do? He took Abraham outside under the desert sky, and he told him to number the stars. So would his offspring be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.